In the two previous videos, we learned to interpret and compare financial statements. In this video, we'll learn how to use financial statements to project a plan. We'll begin by using the percentage of sales method to create a pro forma or projected financial statement. Then we'll look at the relationship between something called external financing needed, EFN, and growth, as well as how to determine internal and sustainable growth rates. The percentage of sales method dictates that accounts are projected depending on a firm's predicted sales. Beginning with our basic statement of comprehensive income once again, let's suppose we predict increased sales of 25% in the coming year. We would make 1,612 times 1.25 in sales. One of our underlying assumptions is that costs run in proportion to sales, meaning that they too would rise 25% from 752 to 940. We then proceed to fill out the rest of the statement as usual, subtracting interest, then taxes, and paying out dividends, which is calculated here assuming a 10% payout. However, with a statement of financial position, not everything varies with sales. The accounts that will vary depend on the particular firm. In our example, let's assume that on the asset side, accounts do vary in proportion to sales, and on the liability side, only accounts payable varies because we can reasonably expect that we will need to place more orders with suppliers with increasing sales. Let's calculate how much they change by. Our first step is to restate these accounts as percentages of sales, so we divide each by the current sales figure, 1,612. Our second step is to multiply each of these percentage amounts by the projected sales figure, 2015, to get the new amount each of these accounts will increase to in proportion with the increase in sales. As for the accounts that do not vary directly with sales, namely notes payable, long-term debt, and common stock, we leave them unchanged for now. Retained earnings does vary with sales, but we can't follow the two-step process with this. We have to calculate it explicitly, like we did when creating a pro forma statement of comprehensive income. On that, we had 630 as addition to retained earnings. You'll notice that the balance sheet doesn't balance. The assets are 5,205, but the liabilities and equity add up to 4,939.5. Recalling the financial position identity, assets equal liabilities plus equity, we know that we must be missing some amount of money on the right-hand side. This missing amount is called external financing needed, EFN, which is money that we will need to raise in order to be able to sustain the projected growth in sales. We can obtain it by subtracting the pro forma total assets by the pro forma total liabilities and equity. When we do this, we get $265.5 million. Restating it in a different way, this means that in order to be able to support the increased sales, we will need to raise $265.5 million through debt and/or equity financing. This is a decision for management to make based on their preferences and goals. For example, if management wants to maintain the same net working capital, they might be inclined to take on only an amount of short-term debt which corresponds with the increase in short-term assets. It's important to point out that what we've done here is assume that our firm is producing at 100% capacity, but more often than not, businesses operate at below capacity. In other words, they are not fully using their fixed assets. For example, a factory is only 90% staffed and can accommodate more workers and a higher rate of production. How would this scenario affect our EFN? Suppose our current sales figure, 1,612, is the figure when our company was operating at 90% capacity. That means we could potentially handle up to 1,791.11 in sales before we need to acquire additional fixed assets to raise our production levels. If our projected increase in sales is less than 1,791.11, we needn't go any further. EFN is zero. If projected sales exceed full capacity sales, we need to find out the exact amount we will have to spend on increasing fixed assets. Our first step to do this is dividing our fixed assets of 3,200 by full capacity sales, 1,791.11, to get the rate at which fixed assets increase for every dollar in sales beyond full capacity. Our second step is to multiply that rate by the projected sales amount. We should get the pro forma fixed asset amount of 3,040, which is less than the earlier 3,200. This reduces our total assets by 160 to 5,045. But our liability side is still 4,939.5. Subtracting them again, we obtain the new EFN of 105.5. In sum, we have to raise less money externally in order to finance our growth in sales as a result of having some excess capacity. Up until now, we've been talking about growth in sales as if it's just something that happens to firms, but we all know that many businesses actively find ways to drive sales themselves. So now let's switch gears to talk about growth in that manner. and see how a business might affect growth and how growth can affect EFN. A projected increase in sales can require us to pour some money into increasing assets so we can actually fulfill the production requirements. Not all of this is money that we will need from outside sources. Businesses tend to generate their own money through operations. That's the point of a business after all. We can use that money to finance our asset acquisition. This idea as a formula looks like this, where A represents total assets, G is the growth rate of sales, P is the profit margin, S is the previous year's sales, and R is the retention ratio. If you're more of a visual learner and like to establish relationships by graphing them out, then we can restate the equation like this, which makes it look a lot like an equation for a line, y equals mx plus b. If we were to actually plot the relationship with projected growth in sales, G, on the x-axis and EFN on the y-axis, we would get a line which might look something like this. On this graph, there's actually one point of major interest, the x-intercept. Looking at it, what are its implications? It's situated at EFN equals 0 and some growth rate G. This tells us that that growth rate is the maximum growth rate we can achieve without needing any external financing. The rate at that point is known as the internal growth rate, IGR. But we don't always want to draw out a graph. The way to find this mathematically is by setting EFN to 0, isolating for G to get PSR over A minus PSR, and then solving by plugging in our known amounts. The expression for internal growth rate can be restated as IGR equals ROA times R over 1 minus ROA times R. If a growth rate higher than this is needed or predicted, our next best bet is to take on debt, because equity financing can be tricky. That's why another relevant figure for growth is the sustainable growth rate, SGR, which gives us the growth rate that a firm can achieve without any external equity financing and without changing its debt or payout ratios. This concept, as a formula, makes a small modification to the previous EFN formula in that it also subtracts new borrowing. Given this modified formula, which can also be used to plot a linear relationship, we can follow the same process as before where we set EFN to 0, rearrange to isolate for G, do some algebra magic, and we have SGR is equal to ROE times R over 1 minus ROE times R. To get to the root of what determines growth, we can make use of the DuPont identity, which we spoke about in the previous video. Recall that ROE equals P times S over A times 1 plus debt equity ratio. Plugging that into our formula for SGR, we get the following. This makes the formula look atrocious, but it helps highlight the various factors that affect growth. Let's try to calculate the internal growth rate and sustainable growth rate for the sample statements we've been working with for this video. Internal growth rate is given to us by return on assets times the retention ratio divided by 1 minus return on assets times the retention ratio. And so our first step should be to find the return on assets, which in the previous video we learned was given to us by net income divided by total assets represented by A. And so from our statement of comprehensive income, we find 560 is our net income and 4,164 is our total assets from the statement of financial position. And now dividing them out, we should get 0.1345. And we could plug that back into our equation. But before we can do that, we also have to find R, or the retention ratio, which is given to us by 1 minus the payout ratio. And looking at our statement of comprehensive income, we can see that the payout is 10% of the net income. So that means that it's 1 minus 0.1, which is the payout ratio, and that should be 0.9. So our filled in equation for IGR should be 0.1345 times 0.9 in the numerator divided by 1 minus 0.1345 times 0.9 in the denominator, and that should total 0.1377. And now to find SGR, the process is extremely similar to what we did for finding IGR, except we know that SGR is equal to return on equity times the retention ratio divided by 1 minus return on equity times the retention ratio. And so to find return on equity, we can draw on our knowledge from the previous video, where we learned from the DuPont identity that return on equity is given to us by profit margin times total asset turnover times the equity multiplier. And profit margin is equal to net income over sales. and total asset turnover is sales over assets, and equity multiplier is 1 plus the debt equity ratio. And we can cancel out the sales figures, and we're left with net income over assets times 1 plus the debt equity ratio. And we already know what net income over assets is because we calculated it while looking for IGR. And we aren't given a debt equity ratio, but we are given each of the amounts. So our debt would be equal to the current liabilities, which is 836 plus 438, which is our long-term debt, divided by our equity, which is 2,890. And all of this is conveniently listed on our statement of financial position. And so calculating this out, we find that our return on equity is equal to 0.1938. And we know again that our R value, or our retention ratio, is equal to 0.9. So plugging our return on equity in, we've got 0.1938 times 0.9 divided by 1 minus 0.1938 times 0.9. And that should give us 0.1744 as our sustainable growth rate. That brings us to the end of the video. Still confused? Rewind to the relevant part of the video by clicking on the sections listed to the left. For more, be sure to take a look at the tip sheets uploaded to the Academic Success Center website by following the link in the description. Need a more face-to-face approach? Check out tutoring hours at the Ryerson University Academic Success Center's website.